Give me on that, but welcome everybody, welcome to Michael's celebration. I brought him home.
And I would like to say, welcome hometown Howard, family, friends, and guests. We thank all of you for your part in raising up this boy, this man. It truly does take a village to raise a child, and that's what Howard did. Now, there's a story behind that little slogan, "It takes a village to raise a child."
Being heavy into children's literature and teaching, I used to attend all sorts of children's literature seminars at different colleges, and I met the original artist who won an award for a children's book for illustrating that African folk tale. And the other part of the story is that 3 years ago, Hillary Clinton tried to take claim to that. She wrote a book by the same title. And I was raging around the house because I said to Michael, "That's an African folk tale. But that's also your hometown, Howard." Because they did. They truly, truly did. All right, this evening I welcome all of you. And you feel free to raise a hand, tell me if I need to speak up, do whatever. It's been a long time since I stood in front of a large crowd. I only did that in my staff development days when I used to travel around and try to teach teachers. But I'm greeting you, and I would first of all like to acknowledge Todd Warner and his wife Elaine, my nephew, my firstborn nephew, born when I was in marching in a parade on May 30th, and I found out I had my nephew born. Stand up, Todd. This is Colonel Todd Warner. We are so, his Uncle Mike was so proud of this boy. And his wife Elaine, where are you, Elaine? Stand up, lady. They have been instrumental in helping put this together long distance. And I don't know if the Bobby Yerrick is here. Anyway, a lot of people involved. My sister has helped, my son has helped greatly just keep me upright. But I'm going to thank all the people who, all I can say is thank you to this whole town. You produced a good one. And we've had two little snafus already today. We had ready to show some, later in the evening, some of Michael's highlights from some of his championship games that he played in college. And lo and behold, thanks to my son, he decided to preview the CD that I brought with a mislabel on. And when we put it in this afternoon, it turned out to be Michael's retirement party. And the other thing I brought that I thought maybe somebody would want to look at later, which I'm going to tell you about, Michael was in a full-length movie that he was instrumental in setting up at Rockview. John Hurd produced it, starred in it. Michael got it onto the campus of Rockview. Michael had a 3-second part in it. They used all of his equipment to film it called On the Yard. Maybe you've heard of it. So I brought that full-length movie, and then Wells turned it over, and he said, "Mom, this is R-rated." So I think it may
probably
be
all of age, but
and I hadn't seen it since it was made in 1978, so I really hadn't seen it. And he's on, you'll have to look for him on the cover of the, he's on the cover of the movie. He's there, you can see him, about that big. And the other snafu this afternoon, we heard that the pastor that we had lined up from my sister's wonderful church, Todd Templeton, came ill. He was going to do the invocation for us and also sing one of Michael's favorite songs. But he's ill and cannot be here. So I'm going to turn it over to my nephew Todd to do the invocation for us this time.
and I'm not gonna say. Welcome, everybody. I would I'd ask that we bow our heads together, and as I go through the invocation, I ask prayers and blessings from our Almighty Father for the crowd that's gathered here tonight to celebrate the life of a man who loved his wife, loved his son, loved his sisters-in-laws and brothers-in-laws and nephews and nieces, teammates, coaches, and friends, and classmates. And a man who came from this small piece of Americana known as Howard, a man who loved his country dearly, who had great love and respect for that group of rapidly fading people known as the greatest generation, and a man whose version of America and version of the way life should be enjoyed always took him and his conversations back to this precious town of Howard as he looked at it. So tonight we celebrate and we ask for the terrific memories and the great remembrances of a man who, again, loved family and friends and loved his little hometown, Howard, as much as any human being has ever loved Howard. And that is why he was brought home tonight. We ask that we have fellowship, a great time, because that's how, with the twinkle in his eye, as I remember him, and we'll always remember him, and his great friend Jay Doherty referenced in a piece he wrote about him, the twinkle in his eye would ask that we have a true celebration of life tonight. Later, we're going to have a great meal, and we also ask blessings on the hands that prepared it for the nourishment of our bodies. In the name of our Heavenly Father and the Son, amen.
Thank you, Todd. You know he's a little taller than I am. Can everybody back there hear me?
Yep.
And a while ago, I had a little signal from above. He said, get it going, Pat. So I have to do this. I'm not going to get through this. I'm going to do this. Because this is my gift to my husband. Now, the plan, these darn readers. The plan for the evening, I'm going to talk and tell stories. I could tell them without looking down, but I had to put them in some sort of an order. And I wanted to start with all of the hometown things growing up in Howard. So I'm going to take a little walk down memory lane here, and then you all can look at all those things later. We had so much we had to set up two tables, and then my brother-in-law contributed a few extra things. Paul also placed pictures on the table. I knew he was bringing pictures, but not 150 of them. That was the last picture that Paul took of Michael in 2015, right after Christmas. So the only thing he didn't catch was looking at the camera. So anyway, those are keepsakes. That's when that picture, but they're everywhere. Thanks, Paul.
Oh, you're welcome.
And what I'm hoping to do is preface a lot of what I say with, did you know? Because I'd like to tell you some things about the man. A lot of you know Michael as he grew up here, but I'd like to tell you about the man he became. One thing held true is a good story all the way. A good story. And I think I'm going to have to shout at you as I go down this road here. But Michael's first recollection of being in Howard as a little boy was at age 4. And this story came through his dad. Michael was age 4 with a wagon. You know how he used to put their one leg in and race down the street? Well, that was Michael. But he collected pears from their backyard. And I could walk to the spot where that pear tree was. And he would load up his little wagon and race down the street at age 4. Selling pears for a nickel each. But the thing is, his dad laughed and he said that the nickels never appeared because they couldn't catch up to him. He went so fast in his little wagon. That was Michael's first recollection of Howard, a safe place to race up and down the street.
And also, I might need that over here.
Michael also considered himself the first latchkey kid in town. His mother worked full-time at the Howard restaurant. His dad worked full-time. And Michael was very close to the school. So he would run home at lunchtime. Apparently, he didn't take his lunch packed. He would race home and feed himself. And it had to be fast because he had to get to the playground. That was his haven, at the playground. So, did you know he was the first latchkey in Howard? Latchkey. And growing up in Howard, and even to the day he passed away, he fancied his life here as kind of Tom Sawyer-like existence. This place was full of adventure. You know, kids made up their own games. They played out in the streets, broom ball, kick the can. And he really was so perceptive about people, apparently even then, because he knew who, he thought, the most creative kid in town was. Now, I don't know if Keith is here tonight. Keith, did you show up? Keith Lomason? Well, Keith Lomason was the strategist. He would draw out their games, their strategies, all the things that they would do in all of these Tom Sawyer adventures that they all had together. But it was pure, wholesome play. Parents didn't worry about their kids. And in fact, if one of them got in trouble at one home, the parents would just back it up. All the parents were part of raising these boys. Also, they were scamps, I will tell you that. I'll keep this clean this evening, but they were pretty scamps. Now, there was a rule at Michael's house. It was called you work first and then play, all generated by his mother. And we fondly later on called her Big D. Her name was Dorothy. And she liked that name. It wasn't any kind of bad name. She thought it was delightful because she was 6 foot. And Michael's dad was a little taller than that. So Michael didn't grow to be either of those heights. So she taught him more about taking care of a house and doing chores than any of you would ever believe. He had to teach me. He truly knew a lot. He could not go out to play until those chores were done. And she was a rigorous, rigorous house cleaner, Big D. And once you got to the playground, hey, that's where it happened in Howard. That playground was, that was everything. That was his world, and maybe the world of a lot of you. I'm not sure, but that was a big part of his world. And the characters that he spotted in Howard, aside from Keith, Keith was the strategist. He was the most creative. He also had somebody in our class picked out as the kid he thought was the smartest kid, and why couldn't these other teachers or kids see it? Glenn Myers. Now, I don't know if Glenn is here. I told Glenn that at one of the reunions, and he looked at us with tears in his eyes. I said, I will maintain that forever, that you were the smartest kid. Keith was the most creative. And then, get this, Michael was always kind of offended or miffed that the girl athletes, didn't have their part. And he had one spotted that I remember from high school, Nadine Whitecraft. He said she could take on any boy in Howard and win. So anybody here, raise your hand if you knew her. And I said, okay, I mean, the stories, he just loved this place. Now I'm going to take a walk down this table quickly. Now try to shout things out before I move on to the list of Howard characters, because they really have quite the names. Paul has helped us dream these up, think them up, one night when we sat in his kitchen. Well, I to reporting pieces. How could I do this? Until January 25th, 1964, we were in the same site. We're very near to it. Because it was the Mike Condo night. This town came together. They had a team of people. They came together. I have the original fold-out brochure from that night in my hand. And I see Buzz Bronson, these names on here is Willard. You remember that night, Buzz? I sat with you and your wife right beside you and Michael beside me. And they sold tickets to this. In the scrapbook, if anybody looks through it later, I might even have the page marked. Here's this brochure, and there's a ticket, $1.75, but tonight you eat free. And when we were going before, many months before we might have had these nice surgeries, I kept saying to him for many years, you have to go through, or we have to go through those big tubs of information that have been collected for 50-some years. That, you know, people store, you say you're going to do it, you're going to do it. Well, when I was going through it, in one of the old Pletcher condo Bibles, there was this tiny little snippet from the newspaper. It was so little, I taped it on a card, and it's the very first evidence of his press coverage that I know of, and it wasn't written by Bracken. And I remember, this was during the polio pioneer days in 1952. Way out there in Snowshoe Pineland, they took us all to the Clarence Elementary School, lined us up in a line. Ken Hall may remember this. And then they gave us the polio shot because we've been pioneers. But meanwhile, down here in Howard, they were doing the same thing. And this snippet said, in spite of all the planning for this day, one little boy in Howard didn't think much of the setup. He looked at the sign pinned on him and said, "Aw, they ain't so smart." Now, kids then did use ink. Sorry to say, Michael. "Aw, they ain't so smart. Look, I have my name backwards. The tag said, Condo Michael." So that was the first of his press conference. Now, later on, as you walk by the table, if you choose to do so, on the table, you might see some little snippets of information, wise words, I call them, because I've collected them my whole marriage. I'm very prone to books full of wise sayings, love Churchill, you name it. Anybody who said anything wise, I probably have it somewhere there. And I copy just a few of some of the things just to lay there, because that's what I do. And Michael would try to find them for me. And I often got to use them in some of the presentations that I would give for some of the teachers. So here we go, memory lane, just to acquaint you. Can you hear me? All right. And first in this corner, I have Michael's first ball glove. Now, it's not much of a ball glove, but it is leather. And I found that in his family keepsakes. And I found a very, very old Testament, New Testament, from his, I guess, grandfather, great-grandfather, Jonathan Condo. And I know I have other his Bibles given to him at the church here, but this one captured my heart because his grandfather had him right inside, "Forget Me Not," signed Mike Condo. So, oh my, way over 100 years old. And how Michael loved the Yankees. Did you know he loved the Yankees? And the story here goes, The only reason they love the Yankees or became a Yankee fan is because one of these Howard people, when Michael was a little boy, I don't know how old, but a man by the name of Henshank, and some of you have to know Henshank, because he was smiling, Henshank gave Michael a Yankee hat. That's all. This one, not this one. This one's from Cooperstown. This one's real precious. I wear it on my dog walks. He wore one out and he told me I'd never dare wash the next one because that would be the end. So this one is from Cooperstown. We made two trips there, and if you've never been there, people, and you like baseball, you take a trip up there because it is absolutely wonderful. Now, we got to the Mickey Mantle, that was all, we have every Mickey Mantle thing going. And we got in front of that display, and I wanted him to stand there so I could take his picture. Michael wouldn't do it. He teared up, would not do it, just walked on. He was such a Mantle fan. And then here's a big scrapbook, and anybody feel free, the glue is really ruined all, but the clippings are all here. All the high school stuff is in the front, Minnesota stuff in the back. His mother started this, and then I probably gave her some clippings for it. There are some pictures back here of my little catcher. He started out in baseball as the smallest little catcher we ever saw, but he must have been pretty good at it. I tried to notate everything here with some captions so you know what you're looking at. I also put Michael's first running shoes. From 1946, his first pair of shoes are sitting here, bronze. And there are a couple more pictures that show his scampish look that he had. And I want the people from Howard to look at this photograph with Lulu Schenk. A lot of you have to know her, because this was Michael's first and second grade class. And then she had taught his dad. So I don't know how long that century was, but she taught a long time. And she must have been quite strict. Now, I don't know what a six-year-old could have done. I taught a long time, and they can be devilish. But she would relegate him to the coat room. And then she would forget about him, and he would tell his story how he would eat some lunch back there from the lunches. And sometimes he fell asleep back there. So, you know, could they get away with that now? I don't think so. There are other Howard pictures here of these classes that the people who knew him have to know. I recognize my classmates, and I didn't attend school here. And there are some other pictures and clippings. A lot in my Frank Bracken. A lot of it. Oh, and did you know? Part of Michael's recruiting stories. I'm going to share a little bit more. But when we were in high school, you know, everybody liked how he played football. They flew him all over to so many different places. And did you know? November 23rd, 1963 or 22nd, he was in Washington, D.C. the day Kennedy was shot. And he had the foresight to, they didn't bring him home till the next day, and Michael had the foresight to grab this newspaper. Meanwhile, the rest of us back at Bald Eagle, if you were there, we were herded into the auditorium to hear the news. And there's the picture board that I put together. I made a discovery when I found the senior picture. I had several of those. But when I turned that one over about a week or so ago, there it was, the one that he inscribed to me, to his little queen. And I tried not to put pictures of me up here, but this one right here, Michael's main squeeze, that's what he called me. And that picture was discovered 47 years after it was taken. That was part of a picture collection that my sister had. So I included that one. Just good, fun pictures. And this board of pictures, bless that Paul, he took that to Michael Michael's church service memorial. It was down in our fellowship room. And I have two of Michael's I wore a mice for Halloween. I have a couple of them. I have the blue and the gold. And there's a sweater in the back that he was known for wearing in high school. And he loved it because it had so many colors. And it is pristine condition from 1963 to 2017. And when our nephew, Gary, lived with us for a few years, he loved that sweater. So he wore it to high school in Maryland. So, and this walk here's getting long, but these are a lot of his trophies that we had to dig out, haven't been looked at in, I don't know how many years. That big one in the middle, that big one is the very trophy that was presented to him in this hall in 1964 at the Mike Condo night and presented to him by Paul Hollis. Now all the coaches were here that night. Ron Signorino, Al Hagg, Ken McMullen, Jake Weigert opened up. For those who remember Jake Weigert, he was pretty renowned. And in this little box right here, I brought his track medals because a lot of people don't know that part of them. And on the back of each medal, I took them and had them inscribed with what the stats were. And I have his high school ring. And I only brought it because, gee, our colors were blue and gold. Everybody got blue stones. But not Michael, he got red. And that was a Belfont color. He could never explain that one. And here's his his Minnesota championship ring I laid in there. Here is one of his high school cleats that I used to wear on a little chain. And then he wore his big 33 watch for years and years and years. And then we stopped having it refurbished, so I could probably do that again, but it's in. So feel free to pick all these up and read the stats on the back because it'll trigger memories. At the end of this memory table, oh, that Ron Bracken, he just covered me so well. And 2 days after Michael passed away, Ron Bracken published that story, which maybe all of you have read and seen. Well, this has gone, there's even one copy that went across the world to somebody, but it has been traveled, copied, but we made a few extra copies in case you didn't get it, because it's a real good story. The only thing is, I better clear this up right now. I hadn't thought to say this, but Ron Bracken made a mistake in that. Where are you, Ron? Somewhere in there, he mentions me, that Michael, dated Mary, whatever, the homecoming queen, they wouldn't allow me to be the homecoming queen. People didn't know that. They were afraid I would win because I had already gotten the Miss Bald Eagle and the Grand Voyage. And they came to me. And I'll tell you, I pretended I wasn't hurt. But three people, and I could name them, but I won't. Well, Mr. Eliza's gone, so that would be safe. And two other coaches. And they came and got me out of class one day and said that my name, it would be all right if they took my name off the ballot. I said, sure. Well, he didn't say it that way, but nobody knew that it hurt. I don't know if anybody knew. Maybe I told Mom, I don't know. But I'm telling you now, Brad, I wasn't. No, I really had enough. I did my best. And then the other thing at the end, I know many of you, none of you would have seen or heard of these. And my son, my wonderful son, took the copies and had it enlarged. It's a whole set of stories. Michael, our great friend Jay Doherty couldn't be here. He had a family function. He's out in Idaho. A huge thing going on. And he actually sobbed over the telephone when he told me he couldn't be here. He was at Michael's service, and he went home from that service, and he sat down and he started writing this collection of stories called Mike and Me. And he said, Pat, I don't care if it's grammatically correct or not. He said, this is really about how he came into Howard late, very late. So I'm going to share a few of these. Am I going on too long? You have to give me a signal. I have many, many great stories. That's that table. And I'll try to do this one fast. I put some of his Minnesota stuff over here. And Paul contributed this just late yesterday. A few years ago, Michael was online on eBay looking for old stuff about the Minnesota Gophers. He didn't care what it was. But lo and behold, I heard a shriek and yell, Pat, come here, come here. His picture was for sale on eBay. And it was nothing we had because it was an original, and the reason we never saw it was because it was from Illinois, a game where he won the game ball. And the picture appeared in an Illinois newspaper. He paid $30 for it. And there's another picture that he also paid $30 for. It was his championship team in Minnesota. They found it on eBay. Completely a shock. The story went on and on. Here's some stuff his Minnesota coach loved with a passion. Murray Warmath. Murray Warmath actually coached, if you know the name, Vince Lombardi. No, I don't mean if you do. Because Warmath coached with Vince Lombardi's coaching staff once upon a time. He was the first coach to bring black recruits from the South and bring black players to Minnesota. They all ended up in Michael's team. So, I mean, and one of them ended up, he arrived there with his clothes in a paper bag and ended up to be the athletic director at Minnesota. So the stories are wonderful. We found a book in an antique shop about that coach. We saw him and two went back for a reunion. Saw him, I think, in 2007, 2008 that would have been. But Murray Warmath just passed away a couple years ago at age 98.
Wow.
But a great warrior. So there's a great book up here about that. Of course, there are a few pictures when we beat Penn State one year. Michael kept saying, you know, Penn State has a lot to learn about playing the Big Ten schedule. And they did, but they came along. You know, they really did. And for those of you who might think that he had great remorse about not going to Penn State, no, he never did. He went for the best deal. He went to where he knew he would play. And Penn State they would take him on, but it could be a walk-on. Michael wanted a run-on. And he had a wonderful career. And of course, they didn't play them in their freshman year, so he had 3-4 years at Minnesota. He had a good run. And if you saw the other guys, they're up here, he's down here. There was only one player smaller, the black quarterback from Pittsburgh. And then there was one. So he made a good choice. Very good choice. Oh, here's the movie, the R-rated movie. So since I guess we won't be showing it, this is the new copy that we got in, I guess, two Christmases ago. But if you look on the back, if you can spot him on there, because he's there. And here's one of our favorite places in all the world. This little oil on wood from my grandfather Hoover's little barn in Pine Glen, and the oil spots on the end, that's because Michael was going to try to make this look fresh for me. But this was 1972. This is our place in the Adirondacks that we met some friends. We spent 25 Christmases there. It is the most beautiful, pure place in the world. And after we had the 25 Christmases, one morning was 31 below zero there. You're an hour and a half south of Montreal. The wolves howl at night. The air is so pure. Sky is so wonderful. Snow is deep, which we all love. And we went back and stayed in 2012 for a month and 10 days. And back the next year to stay a whole month, just the two of us, in this place. And it was added on after this. I painted that after seeing a picture of a little photograph of it, just before our son was born. But Wells enjoyed, and I put other pictures up here, if anybody cares to look. One of his favorite places that I don't know how many times we had been there, but he was looking forward to going back, going back. And we couldn't go after 2013 because then things started to heat up for him. Now I just have to get this off. Gee, I went way ahead in the story, so stick with me. Now I was talking about recruiting. Just a moment, how it was recruited at different places. When we came up a few weeks ago, to check out the site and to talk with Todd and Elaine about putting this together. Todd told Wells and I a story about recruiting that we didn't know. So I'm going to, it was when Kentucky was trying to sign up. But I'm going to let Todd take it over for a minute and tell you that recruiting story. Okay, Todd, you're on.
Okay, for several years, I stayed with Aunt Pat and Uncle Mike, maybe 10 to 12, 15 nights a year, because I was an Army Reserve officer assigned to the Pentagon, and they lived about 50 miles north of the Pentagon. So they saved me hundreds of dollars in hotel fees, and gave me Wells' old bedroom to sleep in, since he's no longer there, and they gave me great food, the gourmet Condo cooking. And a lot of those stays were like between October and January, so football season, so I'd come back on a Saturday night from the Pentagon. Uncle Mike would maybe be drinking a beer in his man cave, and Aunt Pat would have great snacks for us sometimes down there. We had a lot of talks down there, though. And he was telling me about the recruiting process. And, you know, he was a guy that came from what I'm assuming in the 1950s and 60s was pretty much all white Howard. Just like the Bald Eagle Valley was all white. And he ended up with a very integrated team in the big town of Minnesota. But during the recruiting process, one of the schools that was really, really, really heavy after him was University of Kentucky. And we're talking 1963, Kentucky. Those of you that knew sports from them, Kentucky's basketball team led by a legendary racist named Adolph Rupp. Who never had a black player. So that was kind of the environment on the Kentucky campus. Mike went down there, and I remember him telling me this as we were throwing more logs on his fireplace. He went to Kentucky for one of those official visits. And right away, the stuff you didn't see in Howard, you know, still the signs of segregation, the signs of two very different classes of people, the signs of people being treated very different based on that. And he knew before he was in Kentucky 2 hours that he was never going to go to Kentucky or play for Kentucky. But I don't think he really had the heart to kind of tell them that. So he came back to Howard and had his official visit to Kentucky. Months later, National Signing Day came around. And the University of Minnesota was high on his list, obviously. It ended up being number one on his list. They had four recruits from Pennsylvania. Three of them were from the Aliquippa, Beaver Falls, Newcastle, just north of Pittsburgh, the steel mill area. And the fourth guy was from Howard, PA. So no, I don't know what the interstates were like, but I don't think you really had interstates in 1963. I'm not sure if you did. They weren't like quite like they are today. Uncle Mike came home from school on National Signing Day. No press conferences at BEA or anything that day. came home from school, and it was a big fancy car in front of the house. And it was the University of Kentucky's recruiting coordinator coming with the contract, the letter of intent, for him to sign, to sign to play for Kentucky. And Mike came up and ran into this guy and said, well, I'm not going to Kentucky. The guy said, well, I'm not leaving Howard. Can you sign? And I guess he had talked to, whatever you call him, Mike's mom, Big D. He already tormented her for a while there. She was home. And she didn't love him in the house. So Uncle Mike was only 17. I mean, he ended up being in college for a number of months before he turned 18. So in the day of no cell phones, in the day of Route 22 being the only way to get from Pittsburgh to here, Uncle Mike knew that he was going to sign the next day with Minnesota, because the Minnesota guy's mission on day one of signing day was to sign all three of those kids from north of Pittsburgh, one of whom became his closest friend among his Minnesota teammates, the guy from North Brooklyn. And Uncle Mike tracked this guy. They tracked this guy down. They called this Minnesota coach at his hotel. And he said, yeah, I'm coming in tomorrow. And they said, there's a guy from Kentucky saying he's going to sleep in our driveway. And he's not leaving until you come here. And I'm not playing for the guy. I went down there and I saw how, you know, what the facilities looked like and how the atmosphere was and basically the racial environment. And the guy from Minnesota said, well, you calm down. This guy's not going to bother you. I guess Mike made a compelling enough story that that guy started to drive east on Route 22, like at that minute. He headed this way to get the signature. And somewhere in the course of that, the Kentucky guy got the message and left Howard. And Mike ended up in Minnesota. But he told me something. I had no intention of ever going there. I was there like less than 2 hours and knew I wasn't going to go to Kentucky. So that would have been an interesting Ron Bracken story in those days. And, you know, had Ron been with the Center of LA Times in 1963, but I don't think he was. I think he was like 2 years out of Old Label in 1963. So that was my story I heard, you know, while we were watching an NFL playoff game on a snowy Saturday, cold Saturday night a couple years ago by the fireplace in Frederick. So that's, and I don't know who in Howard may have seen the guy from Kentucky sitting there, but I guess he sat there for hours and he wasn't leaving. Good?
That's good.
Thanks, Todd. Now, the only thing I can add to the Kentucky story wasn't about the recruiter, but sitting here listening to Todd, Michael was most fascinated because he was taken on a tour of the stables where the horses are. And he said, Pat, they were mahogany and they were polished. And they just stood there by the tail end of the horse waiting for him to crack so they could clean up. That's what I heard about Kentucky. Now, I'm going to take you back here to the characters of Howard, the names that were collected. Oh, Michael talked about these characters forever. And one night, a few years ago, probably 4 years ago maybe, in Paul's kitchen, late at night, the three of us were sitting there, and they were laughing, talking about, oh, kite, leathers. I got the pencil out. I said, let's write these names down. Because Michael had long talked about how we should write a book about the characters of Howard. Well, I didn't know all the characters. And I'm sorry to say, I don't know how many people are left to do. Only a few people here, probably. And I'll just read them. Nod your head at me if you know them or know of them. Kipe Leathers. Probably Paul's uncle. I don't know. Coop McCauley. That baby must have been an offspring. I have an arrow drawn to the name of Beanie. Hatch Dolan. Slab Bryan. Aren't these Tom Sawyers? Elmer Weaver. Now, I did know Elmer. God bless him. He was a handicapped person. And when Michael and I started to date, we often ate at the Little Howard restaurant. Elmer would come into town carrying his bicycle. You know, but everybody that I ever saw, they were so respectful to him. I mean, you know, but Elmer was a character. Art Strunk. Miff Everly. Now, I knew Miff. And I want to tell you, dating a Howard boy when you're from Pine Glen, I had to be accepted. And when I finally passed the test, Miss Everly, as I recall, his little house was right beside the Howard restaurant. Am I right, folks? There was a little house there.
Yeah.
And he knew that Michael liked Raisin Pill cookies. Well, he assumed that I liked them too. Now, I know my mother did, and my family members are not my favorite, but he would make these Raisin Pill cookies, and he would sit out on his porch and have these cookies ready for either me or Michael to pass by. And that continued until we came back and lived in Howard for a while after we were married, and there we would have these cookies. So I thought he was a character. Richie the Leatherman. I don't know Richie the Leatherman. Snuffy Confer. I know some of you know him. Merck Wallace. Yeah. And they called him Painter. His first name was George. George Painter. I see Buzz. And I have an arrow drawn that night. They were laughing. They said, oh, he was the chest beater. And he carried around a six-pack. And he must have been a surveyor. Was he a surveyor, Paul, wherever you are? I don't know.
I don't know, but he watched ball games up there in the bleachers, always in that one corner with his six-pack.
Okay, that's where the six-pack. All right, so I've got something.
George, when he wanted to cheer, he would use the ape call.
Oh, okay. Now everybody please imagine that, because I'm not going to give the ape call.
He was a great guy. He's known all over Howard.
All right, but nobody's knowing him. And the other name I added was Michael's dad's name, because I thought he was a character because of his nickname. People all over town called him Batman for battling, because, you know, there was, oh my. No Batman about that man, but in the Second World War, yes, he had won medals. We have the medals to prove it. Under fire, I mean, newspaper clippings from this man. By the way, he was also quite an athlete. Name's Day. And knowing Michael's 6 foot mother with legs that long, her legs were as high as my waist. I think, you know, females were missed out, but there were a lot of athletic genes. And that reminds me that Dick Condo is here tonight, his cousin Dick. He's right over there, way back, is Dick Condo. And you know, Dick was pretty famous in his own right, a wrestler. Oh, I have another story. My story's too long?
No.
Oh, my son's nodding.
Of course.
Michael's smiling at me. Keep smiling, buddy. And Dick is the father of the Oakland Raiders, John Condo, the long snapper.
Oh, yeah.
So, we're very proud of these boys. Now, a few days ago, when we decided that, or I decided that I wanted a couple little cakes from the Wegmans State College store and some appetizers there, my sister Nancy, who's here, thank goodness, she offered to help out and pick the food up. You know, bring it on down. So I called from Maryland. I had a coordinated book from my Wegmans there. They said the things are the same. I called and I ordered the cheese and meat trays and the vegetable tray, and then they put me through to the bakery in State College Wegmans. And after I got the simple cakes ordered that I wanted, and then the words to be put on Celebration of Life, Mike Condo, I heard this, and the lady's voice stopped. And I said, did you know my husband? And she said, no, but I knew of him. She said, I read his story recently in the CDT. And she said, he also wrestled, didn't he? And then I had to clear up the other Condo story. So, now, that's for you, Dick. And the other character, oh, one other character is here, a new character I've added in a category. Since Keith didn't show up, and he was called Meat Man or Scavenger. And the rascal's back there tonight. The rascal's Paul. All laws. And I wanted a woman on the list. Did you hear any females? Well, what about Tad Peters? Now, is she not a character? So I added her myself. So if the book ever gets written, I'm going to have to find somebody who's old to help me write it. Now, I hope if you're sticking with me, I would like to share a few of those stories of Jay Doherty's. I tried to scream some out, but are you all still with me? Because we all tie together here. And of course, he called it Mike and Me. These are the memories of the private life and times of two friends, Mike Condo and Jay Doherty. In the first part, prefaces and he tells how he got to meet Michael, because Jay came into the life of Howard late. I've given a lot of thought since Mike's passing about my days here in Howard and the relationship that Mike and me had through adulthood. I know that Mike and me's not proper grammar, but it fits my stories. My mother was born in Howard in 1906 and graduated from Howard High School. My grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins lived in or near Howard. My brother went to Howard Elementary. See, I didn't know Jay had a brother until much later in life. Although I was born and lived in Williamsport and Oil City throughout my childhood, I visited Howard often. Being as young as I was, I did not meet the other kids in town other than Gary and Andy Comfer, Barb Gardner, Tom Bowes, and others, because that was the end of town where my relatives lived. I learned to play kick the can and other night games there. My mother and I moved to Howard in July of 1961. That's when I was introduced to Mike. I was recovering from a traumatic head injury from a motorcycle accident that I had had just weeks before. I was a bit of an anomaly to the kids in town because I had a shaved head and I had to wear a black eye patch during my recovery. Gary and Andy Comfer took me to the local kids' hangout, the Howard Playground. The conversation at the playground was generally about two subjects: the undefeated Howard Little League baseball team and two of the kids. One was Andy Comfer, a pitcher who threw a perfect game, something like 21 straight strikeouts. The other was this extraordinary football player, Mike Condo. I met a lot of Howard kids in those days, but in particular was Paul Hawes. Now, Paul thought it would be a good idea for me to meet Mike, or for Mike to see what a kid with an eye patch looked like. In either case, Paul and a few other kids escorted me down up Walnut Street to the red brick house where Mike lived. It was pretty warm that afternoon when I laid my good eye on Mike. He was called out to the front porch. The Yankees were playing on TV, and Mike, who was a big fan of Mickey Mantle, was watching. He came out of the house in boxer underwear and a wife beater shirt. He sat on the porch swing with no shoes. Mike noticed my eye patch, and I noticed his funny-looking feet, and thought we might have something in common. And by the way, somewhere in my story, I may forget it, those feet kept Michael out of Vietnam. After three physicals, the last doctor said it's going to cost too much to put you in combat boots. Mike and I engaged in conversation. From here, I could write volumes if I were to include all of our friends. But this is about the private memories only Mike and me shared. These short stories are not in chronological order, but came up as I thought about two American kids growing up in a small town. If you knew Mike, you know that he had a wonderful sense of humor and a twinkle in his eye. His unforgettable laugh went with his humor. The twinkle went with mischief. I tell you, folks, he was a scamp, disguised in lots of goodness. All right, here we go. Cut me off on my doodle. Mike and me were not academic giants, and I didn't like that, because I learned later on how smart people really were. I remember studying, oh, wish Coach Stabler were here, because this is about him. I remember studying for Coach Signorino's history test, late at the Condo, late at night at Condo's. His mom and dad, Big D and Walter, would have gone to bed. The only way we could stay on task was to make up songs and jingles to help us remember what Teddy Roosevelt did in the Philippines. Other times, Mike would pull out a brownie mix, maybe whip up a midnight snack for us. And one night during a sleepover, we actually slept in the same bed, sure did, Mike and me decided to do a science experiment. Now, I heard all about this. We drank food coloring. We drank lots of food coloring just to see what would happen when we went to the bathroom. Of course, Michael had a tape recorder, one of those little old-fashioned tape recorders. And of course, you know what they heard, and they tape recorded, and his dad got a hold of it and played it back with lots of laughter. And then Big D got in the act, and she was a little curse word here. What that damn day Jay Norty doesn't think of, he did. Now, this story, I call it Breaking and Entering. I gave it that title about this Howard High School, because they didn't get in any trouble. Well, you'll hear it. One quiet summer Sunday afternoon, Mike and me found a piece of plywood covering a basement door at the Howard Elementary School. We pulled it off and explored the dark, dusty basement. We came upon the old Howard High School marching band uniforms and some instruments. We spent the rest of that afternoon playing the bass drum, the trumpet, cymbals, and the tuba while we were dressed in partial uniform. Now, if you knew these two, I mean, you really could picture this. Jay also was next to Keith. He's Jay's creative. Earl Holder, we all know him. He lived here in Howard. His daughter was Cindy, my best friend in high school, when she met with me. And she passed away in 2001. Earl Holder was the only barber in Howard, and Jay, Doherty, and Cindy, of course, were dating then. He was the only barber in Howard, and every male in Howard went to go for a haircut, mostly the same kind of haircut, except for Jay. I had somewhere along the line learned to cut my own hair. After all, he had a bald head and he was shaved. And one day, Mike said to him, Can you cut my hair, Jay? I don't like the way it's being cut. So I shaved Mike's head nearly bald, except for that one little patch at the front, which you can see on many of the pictures. It was called the Harvard cut. And Michael told Jay later that Earl didn't speak to him for weeks. Oh, and then while I'm mentioning Earl Holder, I need to mention his pickup truck. I didn't know this story. Earl had a light blue 1949-1950 Chevy pickup truck, and he would loan it to me, because of his dating Earl's daughter, from time to time. I remember two times in particular. The first time was when Mike and me went to Lock Haven to a movie. We parked just off East Main Street. When we came out of the movie, the truck battery was dead. Back in those days, if your car battery went dead, you could push it, pop the clutch, and jump start. So Mike pushed us down the street. I popped the clutch, but Mike couldn't alone get us going fast enough to start the truck. A good Samaritan came along and offered to push us with his vehicle. Mike jumped in the pickup, and off we went. The guy pushed us right through a red light. And the truck started, and the guy behind us stopped for the red light. Cop pulled us over and wrote me a ticket for running a red light. Well, I have to skip a few here. For football uniform story. Our athletic director, Mr. James Anderson, and many of us know him well, ordered new football uniforms in the spring of 1963. We were anticipating a big year. The uniforms were soon delivered to the school, and the delivery man was told to drop the boxes off in the football equipment storage room, located just off the boys' locker room. Well, the door would be unlocked. Then Mike and I showed up. We found the door to the equipment room ajar. We looked in, and there were the boxes. We knew what was in there, new uniforms. And without hesitation or any adult supervision, we tore open the boxes. Yes, the new uniforms are here. Mike went through and found his number 24. I checked out the pants and then located my jersey. We tried them on and checked out ourselves in the locker room mirror. We were so happy the next day that we had done this, made this discovery, that we went to tell Mr. Anderson, the athletic director. But it didn't go down the way we expected. Mr. Anderson was not so happy. I never realized how many and how fast a faculty member could yell really bad words at the two innocent teenage athletes. Speaking of the boys' locker room brings to mind two other events that Mike and me got into. Doc Edders was the BEA baseball coach and physical education teacher. He also taught me PE in Pine Glen in my elementary school. He graduated high school with my mother. Anyway, Doc Edders. For some crazy reason, Doc Edders announced a new rule that students were not allowed to be in the locker room unsupervised, probably from that previous story. Up until our junior year, you see, Mike was on the baseball team, and Doc was the coach. In the spring of 62, Bald Eagle began its first track and field team. Mike and the others quit the baseball team and joined the new track squad. That did not go down well with Doc Edders. One day, Doc caught Mike and me unsupervised in the locker room, red-handed. He gave us the choice of something unpleasant that I don't remember, with administration probably involved, or we could have three swats with a paddle. Don't like the paddle. I can still see Mike giggling a bit and negotiating with Doc Edders to get the swats down from 3-1. Ouch, that hurt. Oh my, the next one's a dog story. Michael was remorseful forever over this, but he did tell me about it. The summer after we graduated, I had a small Honda 150cc motorcycle. Jay and me went on a road trip to Black Mishannon State Park on the motorcycle. On the way back down the mountain road toward Unionville, we came to a property with a house that back off the road and with a 3 or 4 foot bank along the road. And you can picture all this in this country around us. There were some kids playing in the yard with a dog. And you know how those dogs were always free and roam? They like to chase vehicles. The dog saw us coming down the road. We saw the dog and the kids running across the yard. The dog was barking at us and the kids were yelling at the dog. When the dog got to the bank, it jumped right down onto the road. It had more momentum than it wanted. I could see in its eyes that it knew it had made a mistake. I raced for sure about the wreck that was about to happen. It wasn't a big dog, and the wreck was just a bump, bump as we passed over it. The kids ran to the dog. But Mike jumped off the bike first and ran up to those kids and said there was no way that they could avoid that accident. But the oldest kid looked up and said to Mike, "That's okay. My dad didn't like that dog anyway." Mike turned to me and said, "Jay, let's get out of here before they change their minds." Now, should I keep on with his stories? Because I had more to my own script. When I came to Howard from Oil City, I had already known when I was pole vaulting, this was life-threatening stuff. When I came to Howard from Oil City, I had already earned a varsity letter in track and field as a freshman pole vaulter. Bald Eagle announced that it would field the track team in the spring of 1962. Mike and me decided to get a jump on the season by trying out our pole vaulting skills. Now, Big D was heavily involved in this, calling out from the back porch not to do this. It was late winter, and an early thaw was in progress. There was an empty field behind Mike's house with a set of wheel tracks running across the field leading to an old barn. We first found a long, suitable pole to work with. I demonstrated to Mike how to run a ways, stab the pole into the ground, hang onto the pole, lift your feet, and ride the arc of the pole to a landing spot on the other side of the pole plant. What Mike and me did not take into account was how soft the ground was due to the melted snow, or how fast Mike could really run with that pole. After my demonstration to Mike, he wanted to try it. He was ready. He took the pole by the extreme end, ran down the wheel tracks as fast as he could, planted the pole in the soft mud. The pole has sunk, sank into the in about a foot at a sharp angle, which eliminated any possibility of a ride over the pole plant. He did not let go of that pole. His feet kept going until he was parallel to the ground. The laws of physics took over. Mike was no longer able to maintain his grip to the pole. He sailed a little further and landed in the squishiest mud flat, flat on his back. The mud actually splashed. He had to roll over to get up, completely soaked and covered in mud. I didn't let him. Oh, I'll read two more and then I better get back to my own stories. Track and field brings a couple of other stories to share. As we all know, Mike was a very fast runner. He competed in and won the 100-yard and the 220-yard dash almost all the time. This story happened at a state qualifying meet in Altoona. Mike was scheduled to run the 220-yard dash, and in his heat was another highly tutored sprinter from Jersey Shore, and I know his name, Butch Todd, who had beaten Mike the year before. Mike came to me and said, get a glass of water and stand by the finish line. If I beat Butch Todd, you throw the water in my face. And Mike says, if he wins, forget it. Again, Mike and me didn't think about the logistics of this maneuver all the way through. Mike went to the starting line. I couldn't find an empty glass or any water, so I purchased a cup of Coca-Cola as Mike went to the finish line. The starter's gun cracked. Mike and Butch came flying down the track side by side. Mike was in the lead. As he came to the finish line, I took careful aim at the target through the cup of his face, but before it hit him, he had flashed by in the cold Coca-Cola hit Butch Todd full in the face. Butch Todd was not happy. But as a result of that track meet, Mike qualified to run at the PIAA State Championship meet. I was not able to attend that meet, but when Mike got home, I asked him, how did you do at States? He said, I came in eighth. I said, oh, that's not too bad. Now, you're going to get ready to light up here. He said, I came in eighth. I said, oh, that's too bad. With that twinkle in his eye, he said, no, that's okay. Turns out I'm the fastest white guy in Pennsylvania. One over. One late evening, Mike and me went to State College, probably because I was there, my sister Nancy's. And for whatever reason, we left there and went towards Port Matilda. I could have been there too. Route 322 came down off the mountain to Route 220. I was supposed to go straight down to the stop sign, but in a moment of confusion, I went left down the up ramp. As I passed the do not enter sign, I stopped and asked Mike, should I back up? Or should I take a chance and go on down? We decided to take the chance. But hey, a cop saw us. He saw us and he thought that I was going to back up and he would just give me a warning. But he said he had to give me a ticket. Whenever Mike and me got a ticket, Mike would donate half of the fine. I never asked for it or expected it. He just did it. It was Mike. Buzz Bronson.
When they got a ticket.
Still Buzz. Raise your hand, Buzz. Michael loved this man with a passion, and Pat Bronson. They played a big part in his life. Maybe they didn't know it, but I'm telling you now, Buzz. Buzz Bronson owned the gas station across the street from my house. Buzz hired Mike to pump gas in the summer. That was our daily money. Mike was definitely an asset to Buzz's business. Gas customers loved the conversations with Mike. And I'm sorry, Buzz, I have to tell you this part. His job was also an asset to me. Gas in those days cost about 30 cents a gallon. Hey, I could run to Bellefonte back on a buck's worth of gas. If Mike and me had plans to go to Bellefonte or Lock Haven, on a few occasions, he would tell me to get my car, and he would pump in $1 or $2 worth of gas on that UT. I guess I owe Buzz about $28.50. But Buzz, I'll be happy to settle up with you. I didn't know that. Among other stories that I could add to this litany was the day Mike and me went to a Yankees game in New York City. I drove. I had some idea of the city on the street side, but neither of us had ever traveled on the subway. We did not want to drive in the city, so we parked and found the subway entrance. Mike asked if I knew how to get to Yankee Stadium. I did not. Mike suggested, well, let's just follow all the people who have the Yankee hats. Because they're going to the game, too. Well, they were. And we got to the stadium flawlessly. Going back to the parked car was a different story. We had to ask for help. Now, I didn't plan it quite this way, but I'm going to let Todd the rest of Jay's story. I simply can't read it. So I'm going to let him read that part, and then I'll try to check my notes and see what I missed. Because I have a lot more about him later in life. The man he became, the great cook, all that stuff. Okay, Todd, you're home.
Yeah, I met Jay Doherty for the first time at Uncle Mike's funeral service back in October. So this is the tail end of what he wrote, and there are copies down here. Feel free to take those with you. He said, I want to end a little bit with a little bit about Baltimore High School football. Yes, we had a good football team, and two successful seasons due largely to Mike Condo. The coaches and teammates made significant contributions, but Mike made us all come together to be the team we were. Much has been said about Mike's team attitude and selflessness spirit. But having coached high school football myself, I have another perspective on his contribution. Obviously, the game is made up of three different phases, offense, defense, and special teams. To our coach's credit, knowing that Mike was in the backfield and that we may have had only two guys over 6 foot tall and a handful over 200 pounds, he kept everything simple so we could execute our jobs to perfection and give Mike the best chance to run the ball. Mike ran the ball very well, but that created the need for our opponents to concentrate on stopping Mike, which allowed the rest of the offense to perform. That's what made our offense good. Mike was our safety on defense. That was not what made our defense good. What made our defense good was tackling. Week after week, our defensive players had to practice tackling one of the best running backs in the state. After learning to tackle Mike, our defense developed the skill and pride to know that they could tackle anyone on our schedule. Mike made our defense good. On special teams, Mike handled the kickoff and often kicked the ball deep so our opponents had poor field position. Of course, Mike was our kick returner and he could take it back all the way anytime. So he made our entire team good. Mike was only ever caught from behind once, and it was by Pat, the love of his life. She tackled his heart, and he never had a chance. Even before he grew up to be the man he was, Mike was the philosopher. There was a little closet just off the locker room where Coach Sink set up the 16-millimeter reel-to-reel projector. He would take one or two players at a time and coach us off the film. Mike and me were sitting in the closet waiting for Coach. We were having a discussion when Mike said something to me that I will never forget. His quote was, "The friends that you have in high school are your friends for life." I came to understand that you may never see or speak to each other for long periods of time, but you were always friends with Mike. As Mike lay in hospice, I confessed that he was my first and oldest best friend. I have lived and am still living a good life. I give credit to all of the friends that I made and still have in Howard and Bald Eagle. But most of all, it was Mike who gave me the inspiration to go to college. When Mike was being recruited by Maryland, Kentucky, Minnesota, and many others to play football, he took weekend visits to those campuses. He would come home and tell me all about it. At the same time, because we had the great seasons that we had, I and many other seniors on the team were also getting recruiting mailings and inquiries. At some point, I said to myself, if Mike can continue to play football in college, so can I. But I know not at that same level. I evaluated my academic strengths. I did my best work in shot class. I applied to and was accepted at Millersville State College and played football and track for 4 years, and in the process, graduated with a bachelor's degree in industrial arts. I taught shop, computer science, and technology and coached football for 30 years until I retired. Thank you, Mike. And finally, Mike was a consummate gentleman. He dressed like a gentleman, walked like a gentleman, talked like a gentleman, and acted like a gentleman. During those early years, I never heard him curse. We never drank, we didn't do drugs, and we didn't smoke. We had our sense of humor right up to the end. My wife and I were visiting Mike in hospice. He was feeling rather good that day, and when a caregiver asked him what he wanted for dinner, he asked if she could make him a steak. She replied, she could, and took the rest of his order. When she left the room, I said to Mike, the only time I heard of someone ordering a steak for their last dinner was a prisoner on death row. He exclaimed complete with a laugh and that same twinkle in his eye, "Where do you think I am?" And we both chuckled. And that concluded Jay's writing of papers, and there are copies of them there.
Thank you, Todd. We're back on here. Can you all hear me back there? All right. And as I looked over some of my bulleted points that I had, I skipped around a good bit trying to make a story for you people. So let's see what I missed. Did you know, I mentioned Michael working at Bronson's Garage, but Michael always worked. When he was free time, he always worked. He had the job at the garage. His mother had him shoveling snow in the winter at some little, I think it was called the Telephone Exchange in the middle of the town. Maybe some of you know of it. I see a head nodding. He, because I went there with him and had to help him out once. And as he got older, he did organized playground. I think the first year back home from Minnesota, after his freshman year, he even went all the local playgrounds, because they actually had organized playgrounds. So they still do that with all kinds of workers working with them. But it was a great thing, and he did that in all of the time off, so to speak. I didn't mention his church, the Church of Christ, where he was baptized. Mary later. church. And I really originally planned that we'd have a little celebration there and then come here, but that just got too long. And it was hard to import our real pastor to come up. So we decided on this. But I will tell you, all the seeds of right and wrong, moral values were taught in this town by his parents and by this hometown of Howard and in this little church. I mean, this was a moral good man. And he loved his Sunday school teachers there. I know he has a Bible somewhere we have back from Becky Kustenbauer. He treasured those things. Another note, thank you for letting me know I'm on the track. And when we started dating and I stayed overnight at his home, we always had to go to church at his church. And another way I knew I was accepted into the town of Howard was because Blair Pletcher was a member at that church. And he would come out of his home on the way to church and walk to church with us. So there were big connections. And after we left this area, oh, Michael's dad lived with us, by the way, if you didn't know, 16 years. But an easy, peaceful man. And, you know, Michael got and humble, just Michael didn't fall far from that tree. With a nut didn't fall far from the tree. But whenever we would come back, wherever we were visiting, whatever part of Pennsylvania, we had to come through Howard, up Walnut Street, as if I didn't know, you know, the places. We had to pass that condo house. We might have to pull back the driveway and look at his lot, which he kept there for years and years and years before he sold it. It was a big double lot back there, probably that field with muddy where they fell at the pole vaulting. And then we would drive around Howard, picking out all the houses where all of you lived. 4 or 5 years ago, we stopped to see Buzz. So we went in, and Buzz's son, who didn't know us, answered the door. It was your scientist, your nuclear physicist, came to the door, but invited us in, and we had a little talk with Buzz and Leva. Michael and I babysat for them, for their daughter, Lisa. Did you have a child after Lisa? No, I thought she was the baby. Well, I had to do the diapering. Michael wouldn't do that, but Buzz and Leva went out. And it must have been over Christmas, because I know we were home from Minnesota, you know, and he was home from Minnesota. So we did all that. It was a big connection with that Bronson family. Let's see. Oh, when I was talking about Yankees and Michael being a big fan, and I went over there to that memorabilia, I forgot to mention Mike Mussina. Mike Mussina is my third cousin, who played for the Orioles, and is from Tours-Ville. I'm sure you all know him. But there was one ecstatic husband of mine when Mike moved to the Yankees. And we always had hopes that he would make it into the Hall of Fame. I don't know that that will happen. It's just short of something, I guess, some part of a record. Mike has done a lot for the youth in his area. Another good man. And I know my one nephew, Nancy's son, got his autograph once upon a time, right, Nancy? Yeah. I have lots of clippings about Lucina. Did you know that, I think maybe I mentioned it briefly, Michael spent a season helping to coach as he was finishing up some extra coursework at Minnesota, because he graduated mid-year, and I was out there with him that year. And the only thing that brought us back to Pennsylvania, because I truly think my husband would have ended up a football coach, probably out there. I really believe that. But we were called back to Pennsylvania in 1969, military draft. But before that, what I didn't share when I mentioned Coach Murray Warmath, people don't know, I don't think you do, that Michael was called it by Warmath, because Warmath knew how to pave the way for pro careers, and he thought Michael would want to go pro, and I stayed out of that. Michael just simply said, hell no, I've been hit too many times. Plus, he was smart enough to know that he was small. But I don't think anybody here ever knew that the offer was there. He was just fast. Oh, some fun stuff about the man he became. Did you know? I don't know if anybody's been eating graham crackers with peanut butter, but they're on the table for a special reason. Michael was a grazer, meaning he didn't like to eat large meals. He loved good food, but he didn't like large meals. He would rather just kind of graze all day long, you know, just snacks here and there, and healthy stuff. But once I had to prove a point to him on our nice dining room table, I had little china bowls, and I would always keep like almonds in there, healthy stuff. But he would never look, sometimes, you know, some chocolates, a lemon or something. And he would never look to see what he was eating. I said, Michael, you have to check that out. He would go buy a rich handful and toss it back. Well, I was right. He didn't look. I put some dog food, some of those little nuggets in a bowl. And you guessed it. Yeah, he tossed it back, but he, you know, just spit them out. Michael loved peanut butter. And when he was really always loved peanut butter, but when he was ill and on steroids, he roamed the house at night. We couldn't keep him fed. He was hungry all the time. And then later on, when his muscle mass started to fall away, he wanted to eat all the protein he could eat. He would eat peanut butter by the spoonfuls, literally by the spoonfuls. And all the places after his brain surgery, and I will say just one thing about his illness, never had a moment of pain. He looked as healthy as a horse till the very end. It was steroids that took away all his muscle mass, and he just couldn't get him, and his body was very beat up. But he was clear of mind till the end. The brain cancer was gone. John Hopkins got all of it. MRIs proved that. But no matter where he was, 1 month at Johns Hopkins, 1 month at a rehab nursing home in Frederick, a week in Frederick Hospital, and then another month at hospice. I took him healthy snacks. I had a basket of stuff I could take in, and he begged me for peanut butter and graham crackers. So that's why they're on the table. I want you to eat all of them. I don't want to see any more of it. But he loved peanut butter. And after his passing, we have a Wegmans store that is 5 minutes from our house. And the people there all knew him. They knew he was ill. We would go there for coffee. They embraced us. They just didn't even know his history, but they liked him. Well, I went in there not so long after he passed away. And passed the peanut butter display. And that was just, took me right back. I had to go off to a corner. But worse than that, at home, that made me think, I haven't had any peanut butter since I lost him. I opened up the pantry where we kept the peanut butter. And there was the last jar, still half full. And I checked the date. Now, do you believe peanut butter was expired? That's how long that had been there. And I thought, peanut butter never expired in 49 years of marriage. So those were just the sad moments, the little things that just grip you with the grief. So eat those crackers in his honor. This man cook. The first meal that I ever ate at his house after we started to date, it had to be a Saturday because his mother, Big D, gave him explicit directions. Go home, put in that pot roast. So I was with him. So he went home, whipped in all those vegetables, cleaned them up, put them in the oven, and that was my first meal with Condos. And Michael had thought nothing of fixing. He used to tell me when he would run home from school that he would eat a quick can of beans. He loved Campbell's beans, and I wouldn't fix it because I like homemade beans. No, but he still loved Campbell's beans from his kid day, Alachki days. Now, cooking together, after he retired, we always liked to cook. And he always was the man who did all the grilling. which I haven't worked that grill since, but I have to learn, because it's a big one. Wells and I got for him a couple of Christmases ago. We wanted, he didn't like us to do the meat. That was his job. He was known pretty far and wide for his beer can chicken, the way he cooked steaks and tenderloins. And our poor the July, he always would bring me a steamer pot. That's a southern thing, if you know, you layer in potatoes, corn, sausages, clams. You work your way up, and it has to be layered so that the bottom cook gets cooked and then your seafood doesn't get overdone. I really miss that. Then you just dump it out on a paper-covered table and crack the claw, you know, the crabs and all that. He was great at that. But we learned all that together. We cooked. We watched cooking shows, read every cookbook, you name it. He would scream them, I would scream them. And then our Christmas cookies. He could never figure out how I used to make them all by myself. Because once we retired, we did it together. But I had to do the lists, the planning, he shopped with me. But he had to be the one to do all the glory work. But we didn't make just chocolate chippers. These cookies were so beautiful. And we delivered them all over Frederick. Every proprietor in the stores knew our Christmas cookies and would ask us the next year when they were coming in. And I know my last list had 16 different kinds. I mean, we had, you name it, Jewish cookie, you name it. Every kind of different cookie. But they were pretty, they had looked prettier, I would put them on plates. But it took us 2 solid weeks of cooking, of baking cookies, to get that many cookies done. Wells even took some before Dietrich. And then one woman there wanted a list of what they were. I didn't have a list, I had known this. Now at church, our beloved church in Howard is a Church of Christ, Evangelical Reformed United Church of Christ, very progressive but wonderful. And Michael and I worked with the youth group for several years, and we always worked at buying the food for fellowship because we just really, really liked it. We prepped a lot of food. We cooked for a lot of the events at the church. So Wells and I have now, our church is under a $5 million renovation. It's a very historical place. And Mike Wells and I have donated, given a donation, so that the whole new pantry is in memoriam for Michael, and it will be called Loaves and Fishes Pantry. And in Michael's memory. And I have to give Big D the credit for getting this young man. Chelsea taught him to plant. He had a green thumb, and guess who's stuck with all of it now? I'm having a hard time keeping up with it. But the plants are thriving. I love flowers. I always had to pick it out, but then he had to do it. He didn't want you even to water his plants. And we always grew fresh herbs.
I had a pot. I always have a big pot like this. Tarragon, rosemary. Oh, we got into vinegar making, too.
With these herbs, you just put it in white vinegar and rest it and have good vinegar. So we would spread that all over. But 3 years ago, he came in the house and said, oh, Pat, there's a rabbit in the herb pot. This huge pot, and here was a mother rabbit, chose to have her little rabbits in the middle of these herbs, so she ate all the tarragon. He took so many pictures of that rabbit and just babied it while they stayed right there. That we had to do other herbs, and one then underneath our deck, up on the rafters, year after year, we had a couple of derelict robins. I swear they came back every year. They would build a nest up there, and all that dirt, building the nest, and you know what else, all down on the brick patio underneath. Well, he wouldn't let me take down the nest, even when she first started building. So, of course, we raised many robins. And a couple years ago, I went down underneath to the TV room through outside, and here he has a big patio cushion underneath that robin's nest in case any robins fell out. He really did love animals and pets, and at his house, and I'm almost to the end, thank goodness, his mother had a root, she was wonderful, but she had an aversion to pets and animals. Now, Michael was allowed to have one dog in his life. It must have been a little hound, I don't know. And in those days, dogs, you know, always had a doghouse and stayed outdoors. Well, one day he came home and there was no Spike. Spike was gone. His mom and dad said Spike hanged himself. We don't know, but that was the story. And then in high school, he got a pet rabbit, thanks to my mother, who raised rabbits. And of course, his name for the rabbit was very original, Bugs. We took Bugs to every track meet that was local, and Cindy Holder would help me watch Bugs because he was tiny, hopped around. They had Bugs all through that last year or so of high school, and went off to college with Bugs in an outdoor hutch. When he came home for his first time home, no Bugs. His parents said Bugs got out of the hutch. And Michael privately said to me, yeah, Bugs is in somebody's stupid. So we always had pets. A dog always, we're on our third Daisy now. Because three schnauzers in a row, and he said, we're calling little Daisy because that's what we'll probably do anyway. So now I still have a little, thank goodness for my little Daisy, her schnauzer. And we always had pets. We had fish. We had no birds. Gerbils, hamsters, you name it, we did it all. Oh, and Michael loved elephants. We collected all kinds of stuff. He wanted to go to Africa because his elephants were poached. So he had a real big humanitarian heart. And I didn't mention fishing and hunting, and I'll try to end with this. He fancied himself a great hunter. Michael has, and I'm left with a collection of guns. But he never hunted after Wells was born. And his dream was all those turkeys. They're so elusive. So I have a turkey call, and every once in a while I get it out and screech it at him. Because he said he'd never get a turkey. And I said that was okay. And his on his bucket list, he wanted to be a fly fisherman. And he has all the rods. Todd, he fished with Todd a few times, and when he retired the year before I did, he would go fishing up near Camp David in Maryland in very dangerous, rocky, slippery territory, no cell phones are useful there, until I said we had to stop, because he had big waders, but he fell in twice and got some bruises, and then he would come to school and pick me up once he got hooked. Had to cut it out himself, but he fancied himself as a great outdoorsman. So I'm stuck with all this stuff. But that was okay. He loved everything. It wasn't anything that he didn't like. Plants, food, outdoors, you name it. Michael was really, really special. Special good man. I didn't even talk about the coaches that he loved. There's a couple of Kenny Mullins here. He highly regarded his first little league coach, Baxter Weber. Gave him credit for building his moral standards and his sportsmanship. So those were little pieces that I missed. But he was a good man. And we were blessed with so many wonderful years, memories, and stories together. We didn't get to travel too much. We had a long bucket list. We got a cruise as far as Nova Scotia. We traveled with some friends that are here and went as far as Old Quebec or Canada and Montreal a few years ago. We went down south a number of times. But we had other adventures we wanted to do. He never got to a national park. And if anybody's going to a national park, I'm going to ride along. that was high on his list. He wanted to do that. We also wanted to do Alaska. But things really, once we retired, first my sister, we lost my sister, and then things just escalated. Had lots of good memories in there, but they just, that didn't happen. I think, unless you ask me questions later, I can tell tons more stories, but I'm going to end it with, I made a little bucket list, I'll lay it on the table, right up until the last week in hospice. He kept telling me he had to get back to Terry Knight's camp. And he says it's a very beautiful place. And Terry Knight, Terry is here. Wave, Terry, wherever you are, there, buddy. And I told him before this started that Michael asked that last week, because Terry and his wife sent a card every week to Michael through all those months and all those places that he was. And we got hundreds of cards from our high school friends, people who said stories that were so wonderful about growing up in Howard. Connie sent a story. I mean, Chris Brower, I just read yours the other night. Where are you, Chris? I just read your story the other night. I was going to try to bring a few of those, but they make me cry too much. I had to pray hard to do this. But Mike's bucket list, Terry Knight's camp, national parks. This is just the tail end of the long one. Alaska, fly fishing, and back to the Adirondacks. So that's it. Oh, and we're going to pass the mic around. Anybody here have a story or something you want to share? If you're not too tired, get up and stretch. So we have a little time, and I really welcome you to do that. So we have a mic we can pass around. Anybody want to say something? Well, come on, folks. I've talked all this time. This is unbelievable. Okay, somebody
sets the great ones apart. They don't have to tell you how great they are. It's the ones who are the next level down. They think they're great. They're the ones that tell you. Mike never did that, and I always admired him for that.
Our church people didn't know all this about Michael. They knew he was an athlete. They found all this out. Somebody here has to say something. Hi, Adriana. I didn't see her earlier, my little grandniece, little beauty there. Hi.
I'll tell a little story about Mike. You all know he was up at Rockview and did the recreation up there. And he always had Howard Hawks go in and play baseball. And one thing on Jay's writings in there was Mike's laugh. Everybody can remember that when he did that. It's just darn. Anyway, we're up Rockview. We're playing the Prisoners, and I'm out on the mound pitching, and I throw one in there, and the guy belts one to left field for a base hit. Takes off down the first baseline, he pulls up limp, hamstring. And he hobbles on down to first base, and call timeout, and Mike comes out and wants to take the guy out of the game, put somebody else in because he can't run. Nope. This prisoner wasn't going to have anything with him. In fact, they had quite an argument over there. And I thought maybe the guards were going to come get this guy. I mean, it was heated. But finally, Mike just left him in there and said, go ahead. And off to the bench. So I wind up, the next pitch, look over him there a little bit, and I throw her in there. Steal second base. Just like a play. And then there's Mike going, he's in here because he's a con man, Ozzy.
They wouldn't let me play, but they played football, baseball, we had a basketball, we did everything. Mike would come. Mike was very special. I like to think of Mike as my first boyfriend.
He was.
I think you would admit that. Mike was very special, and Mike was special to our town. My dad, if he could be idolized. My dad idolized him. He thought he was a wonderful young man, and I remember when they feeded him that evening with Mike. He talked about it so much. He thought that was the most wonderful thing. I think at the time he was president of council, and I think he was one of the men that took charge and did some of the planning. But I will never forget Mike. He holds a dear spot in my heart, and as I know he does with you too.
Yes, Bill Lyon's name on the back of the program. One of the planners, along with others and a few others. Anybody else? Sharon, you work with my husband. You have to say something.
Mike was, when he was at Rockview as the recreation director, he did the Howard Hawks. We played there many times. But I got a phone call. I was coaching the Howard Little League team, and Willie was on it. I don't remember. You were there. So he calls me up and he says, "Hey, Dan," he said, "I'd like to take the Little League team to play ball game up at Rockview." And we had a really good team that year, so set up a game with the Mill Hall All-Stars. And we went up there. Those inmates all fixed up this field, this ball field. And all those inmates came out, and they lined up around this field. And we had a couple boys from Howard who were on the team, and I hope this isn't too bad of a story to tell. One of the boys was playing, Jeff Porter was pitching, and he was on the mound. And one of the kids from Mall hit a ball to Roger Bakel, a boy from down Blanchard. And took a bad hop. He runs to first base, takes a bad hop, hits him in a sensitive place. And kid takes off for second base. And this one of the players says to Roger, he said, "Cover your bag. Cover your bag, the guy's running." So the kid gets down like this and he looks up and he says, I am, he says to him. Well, I was big time. I don't know how many inmates were there. They heard this. This place was static. Roger was most requested kid afterwards to sign on. I don't know what's going to happen when that story gets back to Howard. But that was just brought a little bit of memory with Mike. So we had a pretty good time up there that day. Well,
I I had the opportunity to see Mike play for Minnesota against Ohio State at Ohio Stadium. And he had a great game that day. He made a number of tackles because the fullback kept breaking through the line and the linebackers weren't doing their job, and he had to make a lot of tackles. But he told me, wasn't long after that, he came home and he said, "Coach," he said, "I'm bleeding out of my ears. What am I going to do?" I said, "I'm going to call your trainer right now." So I did. I called the trainer and told him, Mike would have never revealed it. But I told the trainer what the problem was. And then the trainer did take care of it. But anyway, another game I saw on TV. How many people saw it? They played Purdue, and Purdue was marching down the field. Bob Greasy was the quarterback at the time for Purdue. He played in pros a number of years. They were about to score. Greasy threw the ball. Mike intercepted it. Went down the sidelines, was in the clear, and some guy caught him. He caught him on the 50-yard line. And I think Minnesota went on to win that game. Another one, good one, this is a really good one. It was close to Christmas. He was home for Christmas. And we're going down to Lock Haven. I don't know what we're going down there for. But we're close to Lock Haven, there's a big billboard outside that wall over there. And there's three really beautiful looking girls. And they had swimsuits on. He says, "Coach, hold on, slow up a minute." He says, "I know those girls." He says, "I know them from Minnesota." I don't know whether he did or not, but he said it. And that's it. There are many more stories I could tell about Mike. I know one thing. He lost a number of tennis shoes, pairs of tennis shoes, in the locker room. His mother used to drive her nuts. I'll bet you he lost 6 or 8 pairs of tennis shoes. He was an Andy, I'll tell you.
Coach Hag, I didn't see you come in earlier. Coach, I didn't see you come in earlier, so I didn't welcome you, but thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. I, along with most of these people, were hoping that something like this would happen and that you would make plans so that we could all celebrate Mike's life. And I want to tell you that you did a fantastic job. And there's no too many people that could do what you did. Very good. In my youth, in probably my elementary and junior high days, my father, who would be my uncle, would travel up here to Howard every month, and we would play with while the family talked. Mike and I would always go outside and play in that backyard that you talked about. In junior high, we probably played a little football. We probably did a little wrestling also. That was my sport. But those were very enjoyable times. When we got into high school, we got into other things, and we didn't come across with each other too much. But I do remember going to watch him play football when somebody mentioned that Oregon played West Branch. When they played away at West Branch, they played at Phil Spurgo's Hills Field. They always played on a Saturday night. And I always went to those games. But I was very proud of Mike. He was a great athlete, much better than me. And I always actually bragged about him. Anytime, even now,
that I run into people that might have known Mike Condo. I introduced myself as his cousin, and I'm always very proud of that. My boys, I had three boys, and they all had number 44 in high school. And that was because of Mike Condo.
Michael's college number, 44.
Michael's college number, yeah. And, well, as we were talking earlier, that I would be the one to carry on the Condo legacy. You still have a chance.
Mom is praying.
But,
No pressure.
I had three boys, and fortunate enough, one of those boys had four boys, and the other had another boy. So there's actually five more.
Five more.
And you also mentioned about Michael selling pears for 5 cents. Well, I lived in a little town called Chester Hill near Phillipsburg.
I know it.
You know Chester Hill?
Yes.
Wow. We had where I lived on Alara Street, we had a Caddy Nine Tails. We had a swamp in our front yard, a huge swamp. And I used to take those with a friend of mine and cut down the Caddy Nine Tails before they erupted in the fall and cut them off. And I used to paint them and take them around the neighborhood and sell them. I think I charged a dime, though. So Mike and I had something in common there. Thanks for being here. Thanks for having the occasion. And I'll turn the mic over to somebody else. Thank you.
I got to say a few things. We're going to have a highlight reel for the 50s, all right? My dad told my mom, get separated, taking that boy over to Lily Field. I lived on Main Street, Lily Field. I was 6, 7, 8 years old. We'd be watching, what are you going over to your daddy's school? That Condo kid's going to hit one over the backstop of the Big League Field. He didn't quite get there, but like hit on the pictures, man. I thought that was pretty good. He set record after record, Little League home runs. It was incredible. I remember that. That was one highlight. He could really hit the ball. Another highlight was somebody saying he got caught from behind. Well, one night, Belfont, when it was a tight game, he didn't get caught from behind. I think I was 8th grade. We went to games and we were amazed by that. But story about him and me. When he ran the playground, he'd always have football games. And I just prayed he'd pick me first team. And I was a little short fat guy. Hasn't changed much, but anyhow. We were playing, he said, okay, I'll take that Heavenly kid. So and I was like 4 years younger. He was running quarterback, Mike had to be the quarterback. He said, Heverly says, can you throw the ball at all? And I said, why? I think so. Why? He says, you sure as hell can't run it. He said, I'll run and you throw. And they couldn't beat us then. So that's where I started. Mike Condo started being quarterback back years ago. Greatest kid. Another thing. We teach bullying, and we've got all these problems in school now. We obviously do. But Mike Condo took care of the little guys.
Yay.
Didn't he, Willie?
He did.
Think about his job taking care of those millers across the street. With all them guys. But he kept care of us. If anybody hassled that inner eye when we were doing stuff, Mike was right there to protect us. He was just a great guy. Sorry for your loss.
Thank you. Somebody here told me before, just before we were having all that talking and gathering, about how Michael Mary, somebody I talked to back in that corner said, saying, that was you, stand up, Willie. Come on, say that.
I'm just going to pick up where Kurt left off. Well, when I was a little fella and lived across the street from Michael, of course, I always wanted to run with the bigger boys. And some of the bigger boys didn't like that. Confer boys were always there, and Doherty and Mike. And my brother was the worst, actually. He never wanted me to go along with him, so he'd turn around and punch me in the face. And Mike would always pick me up. He said, why do you do that to him all the time? And I said, well, and then every now and then one of the other guys, you know, would knock me down, and you're not coming with us. But every time Mike picked me up and said, why don't you guys let him alone? He said, he's a little fella. He said, you always pick on him. I always appreciated that and always remembered that.
Thank you. And I really thank you for that baseball story because a lot of people don't know that. Yeah, he was even great at tiddling rings. This man, when my dad, my father, it was hard to get him to endorse anybody. You know, boyfriends for me are pretty tough. But he followed Michael to baseball in the teen or big, I guess it would have been, in the newspaper. When I just had barely, Michael and I really met at age 14. I didn't tell this part of the story, but from seventh grade on, when I was sitting in class with Anna and Cindy Holder and Kay Hold, everybody around me, they kept talking about Mike, but I never saw him. I do know that Michael had a lot of infractions in the hallway with Bill Deutsch, so maybe he was just going too fast. I don't know. I really didn't meet him until we were 14, and then we kind of would go to the Y and dance there because there was no dating. But at an open house at Bald Eagle High School, freshman year, my family went. I don't remember that we had too many open houses then, but we walked into Baxter Weber's classroom because he taught Pennsylvania Civics, and I was in that class. And he met us at that door with that Baxter Weber strut like this, very macho. Michael really admired that man. That's who started his coaching, the coaching that kid. And he met my dad, and he looked at him, and I was really pretty quiet. Michael did the talking in high school mostly. And he shook my dad's hand, and he said, oh, so you're the father of that girl who's my Howard boy is looking at. I mean, there's a line that came out, and I was like very embarrassed, but way back, I mean, it just, we, and if I didn't say it, 57 years we knew each other for this long. Night and day. He athletic and sports minded, I did the art side. But by the end, we're like this. When we would go antiquing together, he'd be off looking for things that I would like. And sports, I love sports, so that all fit. We made it work, didn't we, Sharon? That's the thing of his former supervisors who drove up from Rockville, Maryland today. Any other stories? There are so many folks. It must be about time for food. And you need to get a stretch. You were a good audience.
Baseball, Center County League. We're playing at Lamont, Howard at Lamont. Neither Kim Coons nor Joe Kisner showed that night, so we didn't have a catcher. And you heard that Pat mentioned earlier that a lot of people didn't know Mike was a good baseball player, great baseball player, he was a catcher. So even though Mike had no protective catcher's cup to wear, he volunteered to play catcher. I was pitching. I remember throwing a pitch that the batter just fouled off right into the ground, came right up, and hit him in that same spot again. And Mike's writhing in pain, rolling around on the ground. And it may have been Paul, but I can't remember for sure. Someone said, as we always used to do in those days when someone got hurt, get the water bucket, get the water bucket. Mike looked up at me with that sheepish grin of his and said, "No bother, those damn things don't drink water."
Stretch, because that's been a lot of stories.